on that Christmas Sunday night, that Christmas service on Sunday night with our youth program, and looking forward to what they have for us tonight. And want to wish you all a Merry Christmas. Didn't we have a good service this morning?
Amen.
Wonderful service, wonderful praise the Lord. A lot of visitors that were here this morning, some that prayed, and we're thankful for that, and just appreciate the Lord coming by this morning. Amen. And appreciate all those that work hard to get gifts and all of that ready and treats ready. Lord bless you for all your hard work. Let's stand if we would. Let's go to prayer. And let's ask the Lord to help us today and then be with us in this service tonight. Dear Jesus, we love you, Lord. God, we thank you for your goodness and blessings in our life, Lord. God, we're so thankful, Lord God, that you've come by to visit us. God, that you're in this place, Lord Jesus. God, we thank you, Lord, that Jesus was born, the Savior of the world. God, that he would come and deliver us from our sins. God, we love you, Lord Jesus. We thank you. Now let your presence be here. God, move on every need. We ask it in your name, and we'll give you glory. We'll give you praise for it in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Can we just worship him for a moment? Let's just give him praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Lord, we love you, Jesus. We praise you, God. You're worthy tonight. God, we want to give you glory. We want to give you praise, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, God. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, we worship you now, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Praise you, God. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Let's sing this together. Oh, thank you, God, for sending Jesus. That you came. Holy Spirit, won't you tell us more about that lovely name? Oh, sending Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you came. Holy Spirit, won't you tell us more about that lovely name? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Brother Ryan, come lead us in some Christmas songs tonight. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Well, praise the Lord. If you have a green book, turn over to page 413, and we'll sing It Came Upon the Midnight Clear. I'm glad someone likes the choice. It came upon the midnight clear, that glorious song of old.
Stillness lay to hear the angels.
peaceful wings unfurled, and still their heavenly music floats o'er all the weary world. Above its sad and lowly plains, they bend on hovering wing, and ever o'er its Babel sounds the blessed angels sing. And ye beneath life's crushing load, whose forms are bending low, who toil along the climbing way with painful steps and slow, look now for golden, golden hours come swiftly on the wing. Oh, rest beside the weary road and hear the angels sing. For lo, the days are hastening on, by prophet bards foretold, when the ever-circling years comes round the age of gold, when peace shall over all the earth its ancient splendors fling, and the whole world give back the song which now the angels sing. For lo, the days are hastening on, by prophet bards foretold, when the ever-circling years comes round the age of gold, when peace shall over all the earth its ancient splendors fling, and the whole world give back the song which now the angels sing. Praise God. Lift your hands and worship the Lord tonight. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah to God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah to God. Thank you, Lord God. Praise God. Hallelujah. There's actually quite a few Christmas carols that if you read their verses, the last one will normally talk about the return of Jesus Christ and what it'll mean, that the spirit of Christmas and the celebration of it will go on and on and on forever. Amen. Praise God. Turn one page over to 415. Sang this the other night when Pastor preached on it. Joy to the World.
Say
You can be seated if you'd like. Praise the Lord. Enjoy those Christmas songs, don't you? The Christmas carols.
Amen.
And man, I always enjoy singing them. You know, there when I was a young person, a teenager growing up, we'd always go Christmas caroling. How many of you ever went Christmas caroling? Did that before? Our generation, this younger generation, don't really know what it is to go Christmas caroling, but that was always an interesting and fun thing to do, and enjoyed singing. There's nothing like singing the Christmas carols out in the middle of 17-degree weather, right? Bundled up, right? That's always makes it interesting. We're going to receive an offering tonight, if the brothers will come and help us with that, and we'll receive the offering, this evening offering. Amen. Lord, we love you today. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege we have to come together to celebrate the birth of our Savior. And Lord, we thank you, God, for sending Jesus for us so that we might know him and get to know you better. And God, we ask you, Lord God, that you would bless in the offering tonight. Bless each and every family as they give unto the Lord tonight. Bless the church and Bethel Chapel, the ministries of this church. We'll give you all the glory and praise for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Turn it to the young people here in just a moment, and before we do, I just want to remind you, Wednesday night, 7:30, we'll be doing a candlelight service. Always looking forward to that. Amen. Is our missionary, Brother David Lloyd, going to be with us on Wednesday night? Oh, good. I'm so glad that he's going to be here again for the candlelight service. So try to schedule that whenever he's going to be here. They love it so much. We want to make sure we get him in on that. But amen. He just says, every time I come to visit, the only thing you do is do a candlelight service. And anyway, that's so funny. But so that'll be on Wednesday night, 7:30. And then next Sunday, Christmas Sunday, 10 to 11, will be the morning service on Christmas Sunday. So come out, be with us for that special day. All right? Brother Gabe, Sister April, appreciate Brother Gabe, Sister April, the hard work they put in with the young people and the young people's hard work for this.
We're excited this year. You know, I love hearing Brother David preach so well this morning and hearing about the different carols and the background to them. And I thought I'd just share a little bit about tonight's play and the background to it. Back in late October this year, I was woken up about 5 a.m. and God placed the storyline that you're about ready to see tonight on my heart. And in preparation for this Christmas season, how many people here, even right now, how many people right now, they feel like this has been a busy season this year? I don't know about you, but this has felt like one of the most busy seasons yet during this Christmas time. And it seems like we're waiting for December 26th because it's all over. And, you know, we're waiting for the day after just because of the busyness. And as we go and we're in the hustle and bustle of this Christmas season, God dealt in my heart. Sometimes we do. We get so focused on the running, we get so focused on the doing, on the gifts, that we miss internally where we need to be. And so, thank you, Sister Allison. She wrote the words to this, and really just want to give them that honor as well. Just did a wonderful job. And so we're excited to have this tonight. Sister Jasmine, if you could come out, go ahead and set this up as well. We're going to go ahead and get started here. So could someone go ahead and turn off the lights? Go ahead and have someone in the back there. Thank you. All right, we're going to go ahead and get started. We will have an intermission as well. So, all Oh, go ahead. Welcome, dear friends. Come on, gather in. Our little Christmas story is about to begin. 'Twas the day before Christmas on the far side of town, two worlds on the verge of turning upside down. Two houses, two families, different as could be, and yet both find there's something they need. But don't let looks fool you. Look beyond what you see, and you'll find things much different than what they seem. Our story begins on a cold, snowy night, where nothing is calm and not all is bright. This house you see over here on the left is fancy and pretty and a chaotic mess. The Have-It-All family, is aptly named. They have perfect Christmas portraits in gold picture frames. Their tree made the cover of Good Housekeeping last year, and the trophy for best light display, it's on the table right here. They've got presents under not just one tree, but four. Opening them all could take a week or more. Archibald here, he's the dad of the bunch. He eats caviar for breakfast and two lobsters for lunch.
Ridiculous, ludicrous, look at these ducks. We are going to have to make do with only two butlers this month. Our net worth has increased by 0.5%. I know that the dog really needs his own, but these are tough times.
And money's no object for Agatha the mom. Her wardrobe is brand new, straight from Nordstrom.com. She volunteers at shelters and rescues puppies galore. She's very proud of her charity and her gifts to the poor. The kids over here, they aren't any better. They're monsters, you see, wrapped in cashmere sweaters. Archie Jr. and Harry have picked up on quite a lot. Their family's important. The rest of the world is not. Oh, and there's Grandpa. Don't you mind him. His hearing's not great, and his patience is thin. But right next door, it's a whole different world, with Cletus and Ethel and little Willie and Pearl. These are the Meekways, and their bond is tight. They're in church every Sunday, fifth pew on the right. Life hasn't been fair and has dealt some hard knocks, but their faith has stood firm, anchored on a rock. They lean on their God and all he can do, because when all else has crumbled, they found his word true.
Definitely did. Sweetheart, if there was one thing your father ever did right, it was So this year, when the budget didn't leave much for gifts, no one was angry or jealous or miffed. They did their best to make giving a game. They each got $5 and then drew a name. At once, they flocked to Goodwill with their person in mind to spend their $5 the perfect gift to find. Pearl found Cletus a watch that won't run. It's got a few scratches and the clasp comes undone. Cletus found Ethel some perfume, still half full. And Ethel found Willie a play set of tools. Willie couldn't wait to see Pearl's face. He'd wrapped her gift special with ribbons and lace. When the box came open, no one knew what to do, because what on earth was it? No one had a clue. They laughed all night long about the gift Willie found, and in the cozy small house, it was a beautiful sound. These houses next door, what could they possibly need? One has stuff, the other faith. That's enough, it would seem. But here's where the script flips upside down for the lives of the two families on the far side of town. When tragedy strikes, we then see the need that everything was not as it always had seemed. The kids are out playing on this cold, windy day until everything changes in an unthinkable way.
All right, can we have the lights? We're going to do intermission now.
Isn't that great?
Yeah.
Wow. If I ever had an emergency, that would be the guys who show up to get me right there. That's what would come for me. Pick me up by my arms and my legs and throw me on a cot and haul me out. Wow. All right, that's great. We're going to have the kids' choir. They've prepared for tonight, and so we want the kids' choir to come and prepare to sing for us tonight. They're going to stand right up here in front, guys, okay? Stand. Don't bother the snowballs, okay? Don't want you to get cold or anything. Okay. Yes. What? You did this one? Yeah. Okay. Real quickly, DeMario is supposed to move on Saturday to Indiana. So be sure and tell DeMario how much you're going to miss him and how much we love DeMario, right? And hope he has a good Christmas in Indiana. I don't know if he can do that or not, but hope it works, buddy.
Over the hills and everywhere go, tell them
shepherds feared and trembled through above the earth. There's an angel chorus that hailed our Savior's birth.
Come down on the mountains, over the hills and everywhere. Go down on the mountains that Jesus Christ is born.
Go down on the mountains, over the hills and everywhere. Go down on the mountains that Jesus Christ is born.
In a lowly manger, our humble Christ was born,
and brought us all salvation that blessed Christmas morn.
Oh, that was wonderful, guys. You did a great job. You did a great job. All right. All right. All right, Brother Gabe, there you are.
All right. All right, we're going to get the lights, and then we'll go ahead and get started after the song fades out.
The meek ways are shaken, rocked to their core. They've prayed for the have-it-alls, but want to do more. They'd kept their receipts from the gifts they had bought, and back to Goodwill they went without a second thought. They returned the perfume, the watch, and the tools, and Pearl's thing, which they'd all come to think was pretty cool. $20 wasn't much, but it would have to do. It's enough to say we care about you. They went to the hospital, swallowing back fear, sure that the have-it-alls would say, "What are you doing here?" Imagine their shock when they opened the door and saw this family alone. 1, 2, 3, 4. No flowers, no cards, not a single balloon. Not one single sign or a get well soon. No one had shown up for the Habitalls till now. And the Meekways were wishing they hadn't waited till now. Something about the little girl struck a chord, and for the first time, the Habitalls found something they couldn't afford. It wasn't about the basket, though that's what they brought. It was the sacrificing love that prompted the thought. It was how they had joy that didn't come from their stuff. Their life had real meaning, and that was enough. The Habitalls hadn't found it, and they'd tried everything, from volunteering at shelters to PS-15s. One hospital visit. Who could have thought? All the difference a simple kindness has brought. They walk through the church door, every family member, for the first time that any of them can remember. The sermon was simple, but the message profound. Light was in reach, and hope could be found. They knelt at the altar, this family of four, to meet the Jesus they'd seen in the family next door. It's a message worth sharing to the rich and the poor. The have-it-alls and meekways couldn't agree more. Now this calls for a party, Miss Have-It-All insists, to celebrate new beginnings and make up for years missed. Remember we told you that was a story of need? And things aren't ever what they seem. In one house, the need was to find purpose and peace, to find rest for the weary and strength for the weak. Next door, they had hope to light up their way. What they needed to learn was how to give it away. Our story ends well, but this story's not true. So the real question is, in which house are you?
Let's leave the lights off. Let's leave the lights off for a second. You know, as I begin to think about the story of Mary and Joseph and Jesus, I begin to think of when Jesus was still a young man. He was just a little older. He was 12 years old. And Mary and Joseph had went to Jerusalem. They had been part of the worship there. And they were here running here and there, and they lost Jesus. And so in Luke chapter 2, right after the Christmas story, and it says, "Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when they were 12, when he was 12 years old, they went to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast. And when they had fulfilled the days, as they returned, the child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem. And Joseph and his mother knew not of it. But they, supposing him to have been in the company, went a day's journey, and they sought him among their kinsfolk and acquaintance. And when they found him not, they turned back again into Jerusalem, seeking him. And it came to pass, after 3 days, they found him in the temple." They found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the doctors, both hearing him and asking them questions. You see, Mary and Joseph, even the parents of Jesus, throughout their life, at one point, they lost Jesus as well. And where they found him again was in the church, in the church house. You know, that's the place that you're going to find Jesus, is right here tonight. You know, we could get busy running here and running there during the Christmas season. It can be busy. We can get our priorities misaligned. You know, the have-it-alls, they had it all. They had their idea of what they wanted for Christmas, but their hearts were empty. You know, the message to the last church there in Revelation is that because they needed nothing, they found themselves empty. And that might be us here tonight. We're busy running here and running there in this Christmas season, trying to grab this present or go to this thing or to do that. And we've lost Jesus. This is your opportunity tonight. And this is what the youth group wanted to extend to you tonight, is an opportunity to refocus your attention this Christmas season to the one thing that matters, Jesus Christ. I mean, he's the one that brings true peace, true fulfillment. And you know, you find here, there the meekways were. They didn't have a lot. They made do with what they had. But on the inside, they had it all. You know, here tonight, we may have everything on the outside in our homes, but the inside we're feeling empty as well because we've lost Jesus. This is the opportunity that we can have here tonight. I say, Lord, I'm going to make a decision here tonight to refocus my life, refocus my vision to you during this Christmas season, and to see what truly matters. Praise the Lord. Let's all stand here tonight. Sister Ruth, would you go to the piano and help us with the song? Amen. Let's all bow our heads here tonight. You know, funny play. but the meaning is true. Amen. I want to have Jesus. Amen. Take this whole world, the song says, but give me Jesus. During this Christmas season, he's that present that Pastor Tyler was talking about. He's the person that we can, that present, that gift to us here tonight that we can unwrap. And that's what I'd like for us to do here tonight. Amen. So let's all bow our heads, close our eyes here tonight. If that's you, where you've lost focus, trying to go here, there, being busy with life, would you refocus your heart tonight? Would you include him in this Christmas season? As I woke up that morning and God had dropped this in my heart, I felt such a strong leading that, you know, we have become so materialistic with everything that we have in our lives, but what truly matters is that God would be the gift during this Christmas season. And we would give him to our family. We'd unwrap him ourselves. We'd gift him also to this world. Brother David, is all right if we have an altar call here tonight? I want to give you an opportunity here tonight to find a place around this altar and refocus our attention on the Lord. And if that's you, you know what God spoke to you. You know how he's dealt with you. Whatever words that he said. And I'd like just to invite all of us to find a place, a place to pray. If someone could help me stack chairs here, someone could help me move aside this snow scene, and let's take this opportunity to get serious with the Lord and say, God, I want to refocus on you. I want to refocus this Christmas time and seek you with all of my heart. Amen. I want to put you first, Lord. Hallelujah. God, that your will be done in our lives. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's all find a place here. Amen. Let's all come around the front. Praise him. Thank you.